So dear participants, today we'll discuss the differential diagnosis of radiolene in bovine. Already this topic has been discussed by one of the speakers, but I would like to share my personal experience as regards the differential diagnosis of radiolene in bovine. Whenever we get any case of radiolene, or maybe a dark blackish urine or a brownish urine, we should consider two possibilities. Number one is hematuria, and number two is hemoglobinuria. When blood is present in the urine, that is hematuria. When hemoglobin is present in the urine, we call it as hemoglobinuria. Now, how to distinguish this hematuria? This is the first step which we have to perform whenever we are undertaking diagnosis. So first you see the color of urine. In general, the color of urine is red. Color of the urine is red in case of hematuria. Whereas in case of the, you can see the reddish type of urine, or it is depending upon the severity of hematuria, it may be a light red to a dark red urine. Whereas in hemoglobinuria, it is always a coffee color, or maybe a when it is of moderate degree, then it is a brownish, and when it is of milder degree, maybe a very light brown color urine. So it is always brownish, chocolate color, or a blackish color urine in case of hemoglobin. Whereas in hematuria, it appears just like a blood, frankly. Then you see the as far as the transparency is concerned, having hematuria, the whenever you take blood, that urine in the test tube, it will appear opaque. Whereas in hemoglobin, it will appear somewhat transparent when it is a brownish one. But the most important feature is that on centrifugation, in case of hemoglobinuria, the supernatant will be in case of hematuria, the supernatant will be clear and there will be red blood cells at the bottom. Here you can see the red blood cells there at the bottom. Whereas in case of hemoglobinuria, there is no change in color. The color will be maintained as it is. So wherever centrifuge machine is available or laboratory is available, yes, we can go for a centrifugation. But what to do under the field conditions where centrifuge machine is not available? Here you have to keep the urine undisturbed, maybe in a test tube stand, or you can take this urine sample, maybe in a glass vial, and you can keep it undisturbed. Keep it for 1 hour, or half an hour, or 2 hours. After half an hour, if it is a hematuria, then the RBCs will start settling down at the bottom. The top of the urine will be very light in color, or maybe normal color. Middle portion will be somewhat darker, and our lower portion you will find more dark. Whereas in hemoglobinuria, there will be no change in color. So this is also possible under the field conditions where centrifuge machine is not up. So last criteria for differential diagnosis, that is see the microscopic examination. In case of hemoglobinuria also, there will be some sediment. But that sediment is in minute quantity, and that is always a greenish type of sediment. And if you take that greenish sediment on a glass light, put cover slip, you will find casts are formed. Whereas in case of hematuria, if you take sediment will be there, and if you take that sediment on a glass light and put a cover slip, you will find red blood cells. So this is also very easy. But under field condition, better to keep the urine sample undisturbed for half an hour to 1 hour and see the changes in the color of urine. Again, I would like to stress, there is no change in the color of urine. If as it is from top to the bottom, then it is hemoglobinuria. But if there is a change in color, maybe lighter on upper side, somewhat darker in the middle, and very dark on the lower side, that indicates that RBCs are going down, they are coming down, and they are settling down, and you can know the difference. Even indirectly, this radiolarian can be diagnosed. The radiolarian can be diagnosed just by seeing the serum or plasma. Here you can see the difference. In case of hematuria, there is no hemolytic crisis. There is no hemolytic crisis. There is no problem in the blood as such. So there is no hemolytic crisis. Therefore, whenever you centrifuge the blood sample, then you will find that the plasma is yellowish in case of the cows and maybe a clear in case of the buffalo, in case of hematuria. In case of hemoglobinuria, you will find that the plasma is reddish in nature. This indicates there is hemolysis. So this is an indirect way of making a differential diagnosis of radiolarian. Once it is clear that it is a hemoglobinuria, then what are the different possibilities? Number one possibility, that is of PTH, that has been well described by one of the speakers earlier sessions. The other is a babesiosis that has also been explained to you. Here, I would like to share some photographs of this PPH. In case of the PPH, you can note the reddish colored urine. You can see the coffee colored urine, the pale mucous membranes, or maybe a slightly yellowish. And the straining by defecation is a very characteristic and coffee. These are the four important symptoms. But subnormal body temperature is a character, sorry, the normal to subnormal body temperature is a characteristic of a PPH. In our study, we have seen that in 70% cases of PPH, body temperature is normal. In 15% cases, the body temperature may be subnormal, particularly those cases which are presented during winter in early morning hours, cool hours of the day. Whereas those cases which are presented during hot part of the day, during summer, they exhibit somewhat elevated temperature. So 10 to 15% elevated, in 10 to 15% cases normal, whereas in 70% cases, the body temperature is normal. So this is one characteristic finding. And this is accompanied by these symptoms. In a recently covered IV, 65% of the cases they were recorded between 2 to 4 weeks of calving, but this disease may occur in advanced pregnant animals or at any stage of lactation, this disease may occur. Just with this introduction, I will come to the differential diagnosis of PPH or radiolarian with the babesiosis. So in babesiosis, when we compare this PPH and babesiosis, PPH is common in buffaloes, but it does occur in cats. So the chances of PPH in buffalo, they are to the extent of 90%, whereas in cows, the chances of PPH, they are to the extent of 10%. In general, just I have cows. When we compare it to the babesiosis is more common in cattle. It is more common in cattle, very less common in buffalo. We have recorded some cases, but they are, very rare. They rarely we find babesiosis when we compare it with the cattle. So if you get 9 cases of babesiosis in cattle, you are likely to get 1 case of babesiosis. As against, if you get 9 cases of PPH in a buffalo, you are likely to get 1 case of PPH in a cattle. So this is the basic difference. So species factor should be considered in differential diagnosis. The babesiosis history of tick infestation is important, but that is again not much important because we have recorded several cases of babesiosis even without tick infestation. But if it is there, then yes, chances of babesiosis are more. Stress factors that play role in babesiosis, heavy work, high yield, and climate, particularly in case of cows, high yield, even PPH occurs in high yielding animals, and babesiosis is also like in case of IUPAC. Here, again, one more point I would like to share with you, that babesiosis can occur in males as well as females. Whereas PPH is a disease of males only. So this is one more interesting point. If there is a radiolarian or hemoglobinuria in males, it is more likely to be a babesiosis. Another characteristic feature of babesiosis is the presence of fever. in BPH-I2, that in 70% cases, the body temperature is normal, 50% subnormal, and maybe 10% cases slightly elevated in paracetamol or like that. But in babesiosis, usually the temperature is high. 70% cases of babesiosis, there is a fever. So this is the difference. Even in the babesiosis, we have recorded subnormal body temperature, maybe 10 to 12% cases, and even normal temperature. But in 70% cases, body temperature is elevated. At this point, helps in the differential diagnosis. Then blood smear is positive for babesia. And as far as the babesiosis is concerned, you know there is a good response to diaminergy or imidacarb. Nowadays, we are using imidacarb at the rate of 1.2 mg per kg body weight. Your subcutaneous single dose is very effective. Diaminergin can be given 1 to 2 doses at maybe 24 to 48 hour intervals. But usually, there is excellent response to either diaminergin or imidacarb within 24 to 48 hours. Whereas in case of PPH, generally 72 to 96 hours they are required for it. And there is good response to buffered phosphorus preparation of phosphorus. Yesterday, somebody was asked the question whether we should go for oral sodium acid phosphate or not. I have the opinion if the good parenteral preparations nowadays they are available in the market, and we should preference for the parenteral preparations, those will help us a lot in reducing the stress and hastening the recovery. So, recovery will be faster and it will be more effective. So you should go for phosphorus preparations daily for 3 to 4 days. Here, so see, in PPH, I have seen 96, that is the cutoff level required for the recovery, whereas here it is the 48 hours. Then leptospirosis has been discussed. Again, in cows, usually there is a red urine. In adult animals, usually there is a jaundice. And it is common maybe in Gujarat and Konkani, Maharashtra, and see the paddy growing areas. Or where the water logging is there. And these cases do not give response to either sodium acid phosphate or diaminergin. And see, leptospirosis is prevalent in human population as well as even the different animal population. And the bacillary hemoglobinuria is very rare. I have not come across with any case of bacillary. It is a disease of bovines, particularly cattle. And it is having a very short course and sudden death. And the characteristic, the necropsy finding mentioned in the literature, the large necrotic infarct. And these cases may respond to the high doses of paracetamol. I would like to share the experiences regarding water intoxication. Water intoxication doesn't occur in adult animals. One thing I would like to make clear. So in adult cows, adult buffaloes, there is no question of water intoxication. But if there is a red urine in a cow, then we should think of this possibility. This water intoxication of 8-month-old calves, especially in a crossbred calves. In buffalo calves, I have not come across, but in crossbred calves, it is a problem. Particularly the calves which are very thirsty and large amount of water. Naturally, I have seen that some calves, they drink a huge amount of water. And so the water toxicity develops in them. This can be very well prevented by providing market maybe 5 to 6 times in the soil. Yes, the water requirement of those should be fulfilled. It's better to provide free access to the water for 24 hours because there, then the problem of water intoxication is solved. Usually, it doesn't occur in adult animals. Then the next is the onion poisoning in onion growing areas. See the overfeeding of the onion leaves as well as the onion as well as onion leaves may cause, you can see the hemoglobinuria or red urine. See the signs of onion poisoning and BPH were almost found to be same. And the body temperature may be normal, slightly elevated or slightly subnormal. In general, it is a normal. And the urine is coffee color, and there is a difficulty. Difficulty by defecation, passage of, you can see, the pasty to pelleted feces. Pain, that is a characteristic. We have developed, you see, the line of treatment for onion poisoning and antioxidants. They are very important because oxidative stress caused by N-disulfide is responsible for a hemolytic crisis, and therefore provision of antioxidant definitely they are useful. And we have tried ascorbic acid as well as vitamin E and selenium. Both drugs are effective. So vitamin E, selenium can be given at the rate of 1 ml per 25 kg body weight, 10 to 15 ml, say, continuously. So that, for 3 to 4 days. Usually, 4 days treatment is sufficient. Some cases, they recover with 2 or 3 doses of even vitamin E and selenium, or ascorbic acid can be used at the rate of, you see, 20 milligram per kg body weight, or 500 milligram, ampoule containing 500 milligram phosphoric acid can be given in 25 kg, like that. So ascorbic acid and vitamin E and selenium, both are very effective, and you know, to discontinue the feeding of onions and just to start these antioxidants along with these antioxidants, give dextrose and B-complex and MGNs. So that is such. In the snake biting thesis lecture, I told that snake biting will lead to urea as well as hemoglobinuria. And we have seen a very rare case of even a hemoglobinuria due to snake bite, and that was managed with polyvalent anti snake venom. The hematuria, it is again, it is there. And see the hematuria, already we have discussed how to differentiate from hematuria. So once it is clear that it is a hematuria, then these are the important possibilities. Urinary calculi, this is the most important and cause of hematuria, males as well as females, and particularly in males. So here in urinary calculi, the calculi may be in the kidney, calculi may be in the bladder, or calculi may be in the urine. All possibilities are there. And generally, urinary calculi, there will be a continuous or intermittent red urine. Usually, there is normal temperature, unless there is an infection of the organ. If there is an infection, in that case, the temperature is elevated. Otherwise, body temperature remains normal. Purely is a characteristic feature calculi, most of the that will be important. So these are the in general features. Then nephritis, usually it is due to calculi, or maybe due to infectious agent, but in large animals, nephritis may be due to calculi. The red urine, fever, and colic, these are the 3 symptoms. On palpation, on rectal palpation, it is when you pass the hand to the rectum, you can very well palpate left as well as right. So on palpation of the kidney, there is a pain. And on microscopic examination of the urine, you find red blood cells plus abundant pus body. Because of calculi, there may be an infection or maybe a primary case of pyelonephritis is occurring in case of cattle and buffalo, but that too in a cow. In literature, it has been mentioned that the pyelonephritis occurs in pregnant cows. But personally, I have come across the cases of pyelonephritis in a recently caught buffaloes. And in those buffaloes, usually there is hematuria plus pyelonephritis. So you will not find a frank hematuria. So blood cells as well as the pus cells, abundant quantity, they are present. So that is the difference. And pyelonephritis can be diagnosed by per-rectal examination. Here I would like to mention, in nephritis, if the bleeding is of kidney origin, then urine is red since beginning to the end. This is one thing. Another, that hematuria may be continuous or intermittent. Sometimes I have seen some cases which pass red urine once, and second time they pass normal. So I have seen some animals, particularly bullocks, they pass red urine for 1 or 2 days. Later on, the urine was normal for a few days, and after that, again, they pass the red urine. So there is intermittent hematuria, or there may be a continuous hematuria. That is a characteristic of, you can say, the renal calculi. Then there may be a bleed from the bladder. This is also possible. So bleeding from the bladder, one of the important reasons is you see the calculi. Again, I have seen calculate, mostly they're responsible for cystitis in case of cows, buffaloes, as well as bullocks also. And this cystitis is characterized by fever, then straining by urination. And here one thing is very clear, that there is a red urine, definitely, but initial streams of urine, they are normal, whereas the urine at the end of big duration, that is, it is getting more and more, So that is the feature. So initially normal, then light red, then dark and dark and dark. And at the end, the animal may white, dark and something. And there is a pain on palpation of bladder. If you palpate the bladder, bladder wall is also affected. Sometimes this cystitis, I've seen cases of cystitis induced by induced because of handling of the bladder by the pack cells. Then the next cause of hematuria is the urethritis. In urethritis, there is a straining while urination may be present. But here, the most characteristic thing is that there is a red urine at the beginning of urination. Why? Because the blood present in the urethra, which is white at first, and in the initial streams of urine. And therefore, there is a bleeding at the beginning of urination. And later on, because of flushing of the urethra, the animal passes on. So just by observing the urination, a process of micturation, one can locate the site of lesion, whether it is in the bladder, whether it is in the urethra, or whether it is in the kidney. Uterine and vaginal bleeding is also possible. In a, you can see, this is the thought, I don't see even at all the time, but generally at the immediate time. So there is excess, the history of excess handling, dysphagia, or evidence of vaginal injury. Sometimes, so this injury, intentional, malicious intention may also be caused, or accidentally also, vagina may get injured and there may be a bleeding. So here, one thing is clear, that bleeding is irrespective of urination. So when the blood will come out of vagina, even, and this is prominent, when animal sits down, in a sitting posture, the blood is being divided. Even we have seen the vaginal bleeding in case of this anthrax and snake bite also. So this is possible. But history of dysphagia will help us a lot. And when you are making a differential diagnosis, see, here in case of vaginal injury, there is a bleeding in the initial streams of urine. Actually, it is irrespective of urination. And when animal is urinating, initially blood is whited, large quantity, and see, thick urine will be mixed with the blood. And later on, it is likely clear. And again, at the end of micturation, when the bladder starts contracting, again, the urine starts contracting and the blood is being whited. In anthrax, I have seen a case of anthrax which is shown see presence of blood in the feces as well as hematuria. But that is accompanied by high fever and a difficulty breathing. There is a sudden onset in short course and definitely in 12 hours. No, see, it is not sex-related, age-related. See, in the anthrax belt, these are prevalent. In black water also, I have seen at least two cases of black water I have seen which passed red urine. So toxemia is the reason. Actually, it has not been mentioned anywhere in the literature, but we have come across, and that is possible because of toxemia leading to hemorrhage even in the black. There you will find a few characteristic feature of black water. I was talking about a rare case of hematuria, actually. Vaginal bleeding. So it's like see, this animal widened the blood. Oh, thick blood. Not like urine. And even while passing urine, the blood may come. The normal temperature is there, and in such cases, you would respond to the polyvalent antibody. So So as far as the treatment of EPG is concerned, this buffered phosphorus preparation is excellent, and this preparation is available in the market. We can use the drug at the rate of 50 to 100 ml IV on first day for AVB, Vofloz, Murabaflozin, Zafarbadi, 100 ml on first day. And if it is continued, 50 ml is continued for another 2 to 3 days, that is a recovery. So if the case is treated in time, there should not be any question, and the animal will survive. But along with that, supportive therapy is very important. I always share that the dextrose is very important in utilization of phosphorus. Actually, dextrose and the phosphorus, they are interdependent. Phosphorus is required for utilization of dextrose, and dextrose is required for utilization of phosphorus. And therefore, dextrose preparations, they are to be given intravenously. That to hypertonic, because there is a severe anemia. You can continue decomplex for 5 to 7 days, and again preparations for maybe a 20 days. Medicines like sorbitol can be continued at the rate of 1 gram per day for 20 to 30 days. Then blood transfusion can practice. These are the physicians, how the case is treatment. But transfusion has been tried. So, apart from this, again, I would like to discuss another phosphorus deficiency disorder, that is osteomalacia, and in a brief. See, osteomalacia is one of the important metabolic disorders. It has not been given a proper place under the metabolic diseases, but it is really an important metabolic bone disorder in our country. This disease is characterized by softening of the bones. You all know that rickets is a disease of bone disorder of young animals. Osteomalacia, it is often in other animals, osteoporosis, animals. So there are several synonyms for this disease. This disease is economically very important because characterized by substantial loss of milk production and fertility, and the recovery period is very long. See, these are the results of a study which we conducted, that the season-wise high incidence was found in the summer season. Here, I would like to share that this disease is occurring during dry season. When sufficient greens are available during the wet season, the disease is more common in lactating animals, but pregnant animals are also susceptible. Here you can see 95% of the cases there in the lactating animals. Lactation stage is important. Most of the metabolic disorders we know, ketosis, hypomagnesemia, they are occurring in recently cowed animals. Well, this is the metabolic disorder which is encountered mostly during the late lactation. Surprising. See, we have recorded nearly 70% of the animals which were cowed before, and generally during the 6th, 7th, 8th month lactation have been observed. But we have also recorded cases during early as well as mid lactation. Being a chronic disorder, I think the signs that are being expressed in the late stage. Actually, the deficiency continues, or the metabolic disorder continues, and the signs are finally manifested during the late stage. I think animals are again prone, like other metabolic diseases. But here, this is important, finally. The disease of animals which are exclusively maintained on the dry fodder. The animals which are receiving abundant green fodder, they are not, you can say, the susceptible to this disease. Very rarely we have seen during the rainy season. This is very encountered or is observed from March, April to June, July. So these are the three causes of osteomalacia in all animal species, including humans: deficiency of calcium, and deficiency of phosphorus, deficiency of vitamin D. So these are the three important causes in human beings. Actually, it is a calcium deficiency. Even in simple stomach animals, it's calcium deficiency responsible for osteomalacia, or maybe a vitamin D deficiency. But in animals, our study clearly indicated that osteomalacia was due to phosphorus. See, the phosphorus deficiency is widespread in cattle and buffaloes. It is a soil-borne type of deficiency. It is a dietary type of deficiency, born or soil-borne type of deficiency. Fire is deficient, therefore fodder is deficient. Again, the feeding pattern matters a lot. In India, the dry forages are being exclusively fed to the animals in the rural areas without mineral supplementation concentrates. And those animals, they are deficient in the past. High calcium in the soil, high calcium in the diet is another problem. In general, the roughages, dry roughages, as well as green roughages, they are rich in calcium. The level is always, you see, above 1.33%. This is very high. This is three times more than the requirement of the animal. Actually, the requirement of calcium for the animal is 0.4 to 0.6%, whereas in the diet, it is 1.3%. Whereas the phosphorus requirement of animal is concerned, it is 0.2 to 0.3%. In general, it is 0.3%. A very high demand may go up to 0.2%. But in our fodder, it is less than 0.1%. So our forages, they are highly deficient in the phosphorus. Our forages, they are rich in calcium, and therefore calcium phosphorus ratio is very high. In human being, is the ratio suggested for a proper assimilation is 2:1. And for cattle and ruminants, they can tolerate ratio as well as 7:1, but in general, in a phosphorus deficient areas, the calcium ratio is wider than 20:1. So that is the reason why the phosphorus deficiency. So high calcium in the diet changes. I highlighted high calcium in the diet, wide calcium phosphorus ratio, low soil phosphorus, leading to low forage, phosphorus boring and non-supplementing. This leads to reduced phosphorus intake. See, forages are deficient, therefore animals are getting less phosphorus. Forages, they are rich in calcium, and therefore there is a wide calcium phosphorus ratio. When it is wide, the phosphorus availability will be less. High milk yield leading to phosphorus through the milk. Through every kg of milk, nearly 0.93 gram of phosphorus is created in cows. Whereas in buffaloes, it is 1.2 gram per kg of milk. This is the reason why buffaloes are more susceptible to phosphorus deficiency, because the milk of the mother buffalo is rich in phosphorus as compared to the cows. Even the fat is high, so the requirements are high. So that could be another reason. The hypophosphatemia is the result of all these three, which leads to continuous hypophosphatemia. Will lead to removal of minerals, that is a demineralization of the bone, in order to maintain the phosphorus level in the blood. And finally, continuous demineralization of the bone will lead to weakening of the bone or absorption of the bone, and that is manifested as osteomalacia. So, the stages of osteomalacia, which we have seen. And actually, we have categorized for the first time the stages of osteomalacia. This is the first stage. This stage actually goes unnoticed. Only there is a loss of body weight. Animal is losing body weight day by day. Milk production is maintained. Appetite is being maintained to a great extent. But only sign observed is a loss of body weight. Towards the end of this stage, animal is disinclined to move. Animal shows a weakness. During the second stage, there is a moderate lameness. Here you can see for a sifting type of lameness. This animal was showing a sifting type of lameness. So this is a characteristic. Here also animal is showing lameness. Then the third stage is a very characteristic, and anybody can diagnose the piece with the third stage. This stage is characterized by stiff gait, arching of the back. In the initial slide, you can see the symptoms. This is a stiff gait is there. There is an arching of the back. And animal keeps on a knee. Animal keeps on a knee. This is a characteristic. Animal crawls on the knee. Some animals, even they crawl for a long distance also. And many of the animals, they face great difficulty while getting up. Usually they make movement of one or other legs and they try to get up, but they face a great difficulty while getting up. And sometimes they may take 4 minutes, 5 minutes to stand. So this is the picture. Here you can see the different you see arched back posture, particularly more in the region of the mouth. There, again, the abducted legs there. The characteristic finding is a severe hypophosphatemia. That is the characteristic finding, and increased bone metabolic resulting in high serum alkaline phosphatase. The diagnosis is very easy. You will get the history of illness for 1 month. I've seen the cases which were alien for 2 months, 3 months, 4 months also. In the beginning, if you laugh, there is a history of usually emaciation, progressive loss of body. Then that is followed by lameness, stiff gait, and then difficulty while getting up. Difficulty while getting up. That is a kneeling. That is the typical, most typical. So how to differentiate this osteomalacia from the other diseases? They are likely to get confused with osteomalacia. See, in osteomalacia, the body temperature is normal. Body temperature is normal. Animal is facing difficulty while sitting down. That is the most characteristic. Usually, osteomalacia is getting confused. Even in the beginning of my career, I face difficulties and I have experienced many of the veterinarians, they get confused between osteomalacia and the TRP. And sometimes the cases of osteomalacia, they were being operated for ruminotomy and the foramen without any. TRP is characterized by the mild fever, maybe a normal temperature. We have seen several cases of TRP, body temperature is normal. In some cases, it is slightly elevated. Some cases, and very rare cases, high temperature. But this is usually accompanied by recurrent tympani or a continuous tympani or intermittent tympani. And this is the most characteristic symptom of TRP. Observed in 70% cases. Again, although most typical, it is observed in 70%. In the rest of the 30% cases, you will find only impaction, no tympani. So here, there is a marked loss. This is the big difference between the osteomalacia and the TRP. In osteomalacia, the appetite appears to be maintained. If owner is very careful, then he will find that animal is somewhat disinterested in a feeding. But that is not appreciable till the third stage. Whereas in case of ERP, the marked loss of appetite is characteristic. There, the milk yield is maintained to the last stage. Here, the milk yield is dropped in the beginning. If it coincides with this, it has seen answer test. Then, another characteristic difference is that in osteomalacia, there is significant and arching of back. Of same, it gets reduced, whereas in TRP it is of same gravity. Here I would like to make it very clear that in TRP what happens, after the illness you will find this and the arching of the back there, and it persists. And it is of same gravity. Whereas in osteomalacia I have seen that immediately after getting up, stiffness is more marked, arching is more marked, and once animal is moving, the stiffness goes on decreasing, and even arching may not be that much problem. So this is the big difference between TRP and osteomalacia. Another difference is that in TRP, there is a difficulty while sitting. Another interesting finding, whenever the foreign body is penetrating, it pinches the diaphragm or maybe the peritoneum, and it induces the pain, and therefore animal faces difficulty while sitting down. Whereas in osteomalacia, exactly opposite, the animal is facing difficulty while getting up. So this is the difference. X-ray facilities available, it is easy to distinguish in absence of even tympani. TRP cases may not give complete response, right, but can give a possible statement. So in this way, we can distinguish TRP from osteomalacia. The next is the sprain. Sprain may also present a picture similar to that of osteomalacia. But here, always you will get a history of jumping, falling and biting. It depends upon the temperament of the animal. and particularly the young animals, while jumping, falling, or fighting, there is usually a history of jumping, falling, or fighting. That is followed by stiff gait. Here, appetite is normal, water intake is normal, and milk is also normal. The clinical values, clinical parameters, they are unaffected. And there is difficulty while both sitting and getting up. Suppose there is a sprain in the front legs, sometimes maybe in the right or sometimes maybe in the left leg, or sometimes maybe both the legs. So in that case, the animal will face difficulty while sitting and getting up. See, this is the important feature which differentiates sprain from TRP as well as osteomalacia. In osteomalacia, animal is facing difficulty while getting up, whereas in TRP, animal is facing difficulty while sitting down, whereas in sprain, animal is facing difficulty while getting up as well as sitting down. So this is more likely. And in sprain, appetite and water intake are unaffected. In case of osteomalacia, they are slightly affected, whereas in TRP, they are markedly affected. Here, there is a good response to analgesics and anti-inflammatory drugs, and no response to phosphorus. Arthritis is easy to diagnose. Joints are swollen. Anybody can diagnose. Limbness in one or more legs and the joint is swollen. Anybody facing difficulty while sitting as well as getting up because of the joint pain. And there will be fever and loss of appetite and drop in milk. Response to antibiotics and NACIB. This is another condition which we differentiate from us because it presents a picture very similar to osteomalacia. But you know, the fluorosis occurs in certain areas. There are certain endemic areas where the water is fluoridated. So that is the main source, fluoridated water. So in that area only the disease is occurring. And then the disease is occurring not only in animals, but even in it is common. So it is a specific disease. And one interesting feature or a sign which helps in the differential diagnosis, that is mottling and pitting of the kidney. See, in case of osteomalacia, there will be arching of the back and a stiff gait. In fluorosis also, there is arching of the back and stiff gait. This is common in both. But in fluorosis, two things are different. One, teeth abnormalities. In osteomalacia, you never find a tooth abnormality. So that is one difference. So if you want to confirm the fluorosis, open the mouth and see the teeth. Another thing, in osteomalacia, we have enlargement of the shaft of the bone. So shaft of the bone, they are not enlarged. In case of the osteomalacia, whereas in fluorosis, the shaft of the bones, they are enlarged. Initial the stage of osteomalacia should be differentiated from the treatment of osteomalacia. This is the mineral mixture. You can give a phosphorus-rich mineral, so that better. Phosphorus in, that can be given in the rate of 20 gram or 100 kg orally for 30 days. Generally, I used to advise 100 to 150 gram of mineral mixture to be affected animals on a daily basis. But we can go up to 200 gram or so. If the animal is high, we have to go for high dose. Sodium acid phosphate can be used, but usually under field conditions, the phosphorus deficiency is likely to be coupled with other deficiency of minerals, deficiency of other minerals, particularly of a bile. So it is better to go for sodium acid phosphate can also be used as a recovery, but the dose is 60 gram per day per adult animal per 30 days. Here, one thing must remember, that the treatment needs to be continued for 1 month. There will be a good recovery within 15 days. Many of the cases, they recover within 20 days. But in general, treatment needs to be continued for 30 days. Thereafter, you will have to continue the mineral mixture as per the requirement. We have also tried phosphorus preparations in the initial stage, IV phosphorus preparations for 3 days, followed by, you can see the mineral mixture daily for one month. Has also been tried. Just you can see the magic of a treatment. The treatment is very simple. Treatment is very economic. But once diagnosis is made, the definitely the treatment. Here also you can see how the animal improved after 1.5 months after initiation of the bag. And one more thing I have forgotten to tell you as far as the differential diagnosis is concerned. Here you see the arching back in osteomalacia, it is in the wither region. It is in the wither region. I will show you the photograph where you see, in case of TRP, the arching of back is in the lumbar region. This is the characteristic one can very well differentiate by seeing the arching of back. Here again, you can see the improvement in the body condition after initiation. Here also you see the remarkable improvement after initiation of treatment. For prevention or in control of phosphorus deficiency disorders like phosphorus deficiency as well as osteomalacia, mineral mixture should be given on a regular basis as per the requirement of the animal. Concentrate should be included in the diet and mineral mixture supplementation. Concentrates are very good source, and they are a very good source of 5 cakes particularly, they are a very good source. Then jowar and bajra, also they are seeking greens, also they are also good source. Greens, they contain optimum phosphorus, and therefore we are not seeing cases of phosphorus deficiency as well as tumorosia. So continuous croppings and deficiency of the phosphorus due to leaching, maybe deteriorating day by day, and that is the reason for the phosphorus. So I think today is we have discussed today the differential diagnosis of radiology, as well as the differential diagnosis of the diseases characterized by strip gauge. Somebody was interested in diffuse type of peritonitis, this type of traumatic peritonitis. So TRP is getting confused with us. Major, you can see the disease which needs to be differentiated. Even it needs to be differentiated from other diseases.